Welcome back, everybody. Let's keep talking about sampling distributions, and specifically, the distribution of sample means. In our last video, we defined what a distribution of sample means is, and we even created one from scratch. We learned that from a parent population of individual scores, we were able to create a distribution of all possible sample means. And although it was a lot of work, we learned that according to central limit theorem, we don't need to do all that work because we already know how the distribution of sample means is going to look. In other words, we already know its key properties. As I've said before, I know that's a lot of information to take in, but this is the good news. Everything that we need to know about a distribution of sample means and everything that we need to know about standard error of the mean, you've just learned it. All we need to do now is go through a few examples so that you're more comfortable with it. We'll go through three examples. Let's start on the first one right now. Let's read through it. From a normal distribution of individual scores with a mean of 20 and a standard deviation of 6, what's the probability of selecting a sample of 36 scores with a sample mean greater than or equal to 21? Let's just think about it intuitively for a second. The distribution of individual scores has a mean of 20, so we would expect lots of sample means right around 20. We're trying to figure out if you select 36 random scores, what's the probability of finding a sample mean of 21 or greater? 21 doesn't seem all that different from 20, so at least off the top of my head, I'm thinking the probability of finding it just by chance is probably not that small. Particularly because we have a sample size of 36, and 36 isn't a sample size that is really all that big. Of course, that original question we can state in a few different ways just to help you better understand it. So in other words, of all possible sample means based on a sample size of 36, what proportion have values greater than 21? If we can find that proportion of area in that distribution of sample means, we can find the probability of finding a sample mean 21 or greater. Let's go ahead and work it out together. You know me, I like to label up the distribution so that we can see visually what we're working with. What we're starting with is this distribution of individual scores, and it's going to give birth to this distribution of sample means. So we're going to be plotting sample means, x bar. And we know right there in the middle will be the expected mean, mu sub e. We always try to be neat about it because we don't want to confuse ourselves. So right underneath those sample means, that's where we will list z-scores. For example, right under that expected mean, we'll have a z-score of 0. And remember that expected mean is equal to the mean from the parent population. According to the information above, mu equals 20, so the expected mean equals 20. And we know that's right in the middle of this distribution. Within this sampling distribution, we know there's some variability, and we can measure that variability with the standard error of the mean. We're going to need to know the value of the standard error of the mean, so let's go ahead and compute it now. Remember, we can compute it by taking the standard deviation from the parent population and then dividing by the square root of n. The standard deviation from the parent population is 6, and our sample size is 36. The square root of 36 is 6. 6 divided by 6 is 1. So on average, the sample means differ from that true population mean of 20 by 1 point. In order to answer this question, we need to figure out where is 21 in this entire distribution of sample means. We can figure out its relative location by putting that sample mean into this z-score formula. Let's go ahead and do that. So we're going to take the sample mean, which is 21. We're going to subtract the population mean, which is 20. And then we're going to divide by the standard error of the mean, which equals 1. So we're left with 1 divided by 1, which equals 1. So a sample mean of 21 is 1 standard error above the mean. Let's go ahead and label that. X bar, our sample mean, of 21 is right about there. And that's equivalent to a Z score of 1. So I'm just going to draw a line approximately right where it is. In order to answer this question, what's the probability of finding a sample mean greater than or equal to 21, we're going to want to find this area in here, this area in the tail, because that area right there is obviously associated with sample means 21 and greater. All we need to do now is look up a z-score of 1 and find the area in the tail. Here's our z table. In order to find a z-score of 1, we're gonna have to scroll up a bit, so let's do that. And right here is the row for a z-score of 1, and here's the column that says smaller portion. That right there is the area in the tail, 0.1587. 0.1587. So the probability of randomly selecting 36 scores from that parent population and finding a sample mean greater than or equal to 21 is 0.1587. In other words, we would expect to find a sample mean of 21 or more extreme about 15.87% of the time. That's not really so rare. In fact, using the standards that we're going to employ, we would determine that's the type of sample mean that we would find relatively commonly. So, if you start with a distribution of individual scores that has a mean of 20 and a standard deviation of 6, if you start pooling 36 random scores out of that distribution, you're going to find sample means of 21 or greater about 15 or 16% of the time. What do you think would happen if instead of pooling 36 random scores at a time, we pooled 100 random scores at a time, so that every single sample mean was based on 100 scores instead of 36? Keep in mind what I said before. As sample size increases, standard error decreases. If standard error decreases, z-scores are going to get larger. And when z-scores get larger, the probability gets smaller. Let's just think about it intuitively for a second. If we move from 36 scores in each sample to 100 scores in each sample, I now have more information in each sample. Each sample mean should come closer to the true population mean. So in other words, as I measure more people in a sample, my data should become more accurate. My data should represent the population better. So in this case, if we're still asking the same question, what's the probability of finding a sample mean greater than or equal to 21, we should find that that probability is much lower. Let's change views, and then we'll replicate all of this work together. You know me, I like to start with labeling up the distribution. So we know that we're dealing with a distribution of sample means, and that distribution of sample means was created by this parent population. So right in the middle, we know we have an expected mean that's equal to the parent population's mean, which is 20. We also know that we're going to need to convert these sample means into z-scores, so right underneath the sample means, we'll have a space for z-values, and we know that 20 will transform into a z-score of 0. In this distribution of sample means, there's clearly some variability, and that variability is measured by the standard error of the mean. We can compute the standard error of the mean very easily by taking the standard deviation of the parent population and dividing by the square root of the sample size. In this case, the standard deviation from the parent population of individual scores is 6, and the square root of the sample size is 10. 6 divided by 10 is 0.6. So on average, the sample means differ from that true population mean of 20 by 0.6. So you can see when you compare this example with the previous example, now that we have a larger sample size, the standard error is lower. We need to figure out where is 21? Where is a sample mean of 21 in this distribution? We can figure out exactly where it is by transforming it into a z-score. Let's do that next. So we'll take that sample mean of 21. We're going to subtract the population mean of 20. And then we're going to divide by the standard error of the mean, which we just computed, which equals 0.6. That leaves us with 1 in the numerator divided by 0.6. Let's crunch that out. 1 divided by 0.6 equals about 1.67. 1.67. That means that a sample mean of 21 is 1.67 standard errors above the mean. 1.67 standard errors might be somewhere right around here. You'll just start to get a sense of that. I'm just estimating. It's really no big deal. That's where my sample mean X bar of 21 is. And of course, that converted into a Z score of 1.67. The question that I'm trying to answer is, what's the probability of finding a sample mean of 21 or greater? Sample means of 21 and greater are located in this tail right there. So if we can find the area in that tail, we can find the probability of finding a sample mean of 21 or greater. Let's go ahead and look up 1.67 in our z-table. Let's scroll down a little bit. Right over here, I see 1.67, and it's this last column right here that shows the area in the tail, 0.0475. 0.0475. So, in other words, only about 4.75% of the time will we select 100 scores from a population of scores that has a mean of 20 and a standard deviation of 6 and find a sample mean of 21 or greater. That's less than 5% of the time. That's starting to be pretty rare. And remind yourself, the difference between 20 and 21 is not a very big difference. So you can see from this example, when the sample size starts getting relatively large, even small deviations from the mean become unlikely. And here's all of that work in a version that's easier to read. Well, that's enough for now. I'll see you in that next video. In the meantime, be safe.